What's up, YouTube? Nate, the old school Otaku here, and if you want to see all of the cool stuff I picked up while I was on vacation a couple of months ago, stay tuned! And welcome back. So I know it's been quite a long time coming, considering I went on this vacation back in September, and we're already getting close to the middle of December now. So September, October, November, you know, it's been almost 3 months here. But we're finally getting around to what is going to be part one of the pickups from our trip down to Florida, followed by up to Anime Week in Atlanta and whatnot. So I guess rather than sitting here and chatting about all this, I guess we should get started. Today I'm going to talk about all of the DVDs and Blu-rays that I picked up, and then next week we'll be going into all of the video games and VHS tapes that I picked up. And yeah, I picked up quite a few VHS tapes while I was down on this trip because, well, they were there, and I really like VHS as a format, and I like collecting old stuff, and so that's exactly what I did. All right, so I guess let's get started. So the way the trip wound up working is we went down to Florida first. We went via the way of I-75, but we split off actually around Knoxville and decided to actually head through the Appalachians, basically skirted the Smoky Mountains and whatnot. Go down through North Carolina for a little bit, South Carolina, Georgia. And then down into Florida, off that way, making our way over to Orlando, where we were staying for the whole entire vacation that we were down there in Florida. So on the way, on the second day of the trip, we stopped in to Savannah, Georgia on our way. I guess it was just a little off the way, but not by a whole lot. And while we were there, we decided to check out this really cool video game store that we heard about called Planet Fun. Planet Fun it was really awesome. I've probably got a few pictures here to show you guys of the different things while we were at Planet Fun. They've had a lot of really cool memorabilia up on the walls and everything while we were there. Lots of really fun fun things to look at, and tons of video games, tons of DVDs and movies and comics. And it was just like this huge amalgamation of just geek fun things that they had going on there. It was like walking into a resale shop around here, one of the disc replays or whatnot, but it was more centered towards gaming in certain ways. It definitely had a lot more of that stuff kind of going on there, but it was just an amalgamation of geek fun in that store. It's a really cool store. If you ever stop into Savannah, Georgia and head downtown, Planet Fun, that's a place to look at. Really cool, really awesome. But while we were there, I got a chance to pick up a lot of different things. Now, the majority of what I picked up while I was there was VHS. Like I said, I'm not talking about VHS today, so let's go over the DVDs that I picked up while I was there. I did pick up a couple. So let's get started. First up here is Virgin Fleet. So what is Virgin Fleet? Well, it was brought out here in the U.S. by U.S. Manga Corps. It came out a DVD. I believe there was a VHS version of this. In fact, I'm pretty sure the first version I ever saw of this was on VHS tape, because I remember actually originally seeing this, renting it from Blockbuster way back when. In fact, a lot of anime that I now own or have been in the process of collecting, I originally saw for the very first time at a Blockbuster and rented it. Basically, I had my dad's account. I couldn't have my own account yet. I wasn't quite old enough to rent to have my own account. You had to be 18 but I could have a child account, and so through the child account, I was able to go up and basically rent whenever I wanted, and so I did actually rent quite a bit while I was there, and I picked up quite a few things, and whenever I saw something new, saw anime up on the shelf, I had to pick it up. Because, well, it was new, it was interesting, it was something cool to sink my teeth into, so I did. And so there's a lot of stuff, actually, that I've found in that way. And some stuff was really good. This is one that I remember enjoying, but actually I haven't really seen it since then, so there's not a whole lot I really remember about it. So let's kind of, let's go over more about what is Virgin Fleet. It is set, it's from the creator of Sakura Wars. It is set in the special Japanese fleet, and basically it's a bunch of women that are part of this super secret fleet, and they use virgin energy. Basically they're all virgins. That's the big thing here. From Oji Hiro, creator of Sakura Wars and Legend of Himiko, they're doing it all for love. Life isn't easy for the girls in the super-secret Virgin Fleet. Schoolwork is rough, and the competition's brutal. Luckily, cadets are trained in the use of Virgin Energy, serious blasting power useful for playing pranks, scuffling with the ick boys, and blowing enemy warplanes out of the sky. So that's kind of the gist here. They basically... this is set in an era of Japan that I think might be closer to World War I, actually. Might be going into World War II. And the big thing is that all these girls are virgins, and as long as they remain a virgin, they can actually use these virgin powers, and then they can shoot down planes, and they have special planes and guns and things that allow them to use their energy to shoot things down. And so that's the big thing here. And of course, you graduate from the fleet by getting married, because once you're married, you shouldn't be a virgin anymore. So that's kind of the whole thing here with this. I remember it was really cool. It was an interesting story, and definitely an interesting one to look over. It's a 90-minute long movie. Came out in 1998 originally in Japan, and then this version here, I believe, came out sometime in 2000, was the original dubbed version. Brought over here, this DVD version obviously didn't come out in 2000, it came out a little bit later than that. But yeah, it was around the time that I saw this at Blockbuster and picked it up. So it was definitely cool to pick this up. It's, you know, your typical Central Park Media U.S. Manga Corps release, so it does have a reversible cover, but it's all black and white on the inside. The DVD is pink, so that's kind of cool. And yeah. Definitely an awesome pickup, one that I can't wait to pop in and see if it actually holds up to my nostalgia at all on this. Either way, though, definitely cool. That is Virgin Fleet. Okay, moving right along into another movie that I originally saw way back when, and now I finally picked up a copy for myself. And what am I talking about? I'm talking about Street Fighter Alpha, the movie. You probably remember me talking about the Street Fighter 2 movie during my shopping guide from last week. And well, the Street Fighter Alpha movie, it came out a little bit late, but around the same era. And I wound up downloading this originally, watching it fan subbed in order to kind of figure out what was going on. And well, I never was really much of a follower of the storyline for Street Fighter Alpha versus Street Fighter and all this other things, but it was definitely a weird one. I know Akuma's in this, and Ryu has to fight Akuma and try not to succumb to the special powers that I guess his group succumbs to, potentially, I guess by following the clan that he's part of and learning the martial arts. He has he has the potential to basically become Akuma, I guess. I don't really know a whole lot about all of that, so I guess we can read what's going on back here. So, a black cloud hangs over Ken and Ryu's reunion. Brought together by the mysterious death of their master, the two warriors must overcome a challenge unlike any they've faced before. Increasingly disturbed by the dark energies building within him, Ryu is unexpectedly confronted with the appearance of Shun, a boy claiming to be the long-lost brother he never knew. Soon, signs of their common lineage are revealed as Shun enters a martial arts competition and displays the same power of the dark Hado. But before Ryu has a chance to consider whether Shun's timely appearance might be more than coincidental, the boy is kidnapped by agents of the insidious Shadow Law organization. To recover Shun, Ryu must undertake the ultimate journey of self-discovery and learn to control the power threatening to consume him. But, with his confidence waning, will he have what it takes to confront Akuma, the vicious lord of the Dark Hado himself? Find out as allies old and new join forces to get against a sinister new threat in this pulse-pounding sequel to the popular Street Fighter II V series. This is a 120-minute long movie. It is presented in 4x3 format, actually, not 16x9, not widescreen. It is only 4x3. This version here, which was brought out by Manga Entertainment itself, actually, has a 5.1 sound, Dolby Pro Logic, all the really cool things that you would expect. I guess the original version of this came out in 1999 in Japan, and then manga's release of this was in 2000. So that is Street Fighter Alpha, the movie. Definitely an awesome one to pick up. I remember it being really weird when I was first watching it, because I know the Alpha storyline kind of goes off a little bit from the actual Street Fighter 2 storyline, I guess. I guess technically it happens. Street Fighter Alpha happens before Street Fighter 2, I think. As far as the storyline goes, it's not been something I've really followed a whole lot. So either way, though, really cool. Glad to pick it up. So let's move on. And my next one up here is Street Fighter Alpha Generations. This is another release by Manga Entertainment. The ultimate fight is about to begin. This one's also presented in 5.1. This version came out in 2005, or at least as far as I can see, it's 45 minutes long. I don't really know a whole lot about it. This is not one that I ever watched growing up or heard about, but I knew I kind of enjoyed the storyline of Street Fighter, so it was definitely one that I wanted to pick up. The courage to tread a thorny trail should be the goal of a martial arts master. Ryu, Ken, Gokai, and Sakura return in this thrilling prequel to to Street Fighter Alpha. So it's another prequel. It's a prequel to Street Fighter Alpha. Okay. When Ryu returns to pay homage to his deceased mentor, Gouken, he is tormented by disturbing memories of his master's killer. In a quest to become a true martial arts master, Ryu sets out to hone his street fighting skills and to deliver himself from the haunting legacy of the Dark Hado. But the ultimate test of his new power can only be accomplished through one last fateful confrontation with his arch nemesis, Gouki. So... yeah, it's a prequel to Street Fighter Alpha, the movie, I assume. What else more is there to say, really? This was an interesting pickup, and I'm glad to actually have it. Wish I honestly knew a little bit more about it, but that's all I really know. I haven't had a chance to pop it in. It's not one I've seen before, but either way, it's definitely cool. That's why I picked it up. So I guess let's move on from here. Now, like I said, we did go down to Florida, and while we were in Florida, we did a lot of things. But we didn't really, there wasn't a whole lot of resale shops, or we didn't really come in contact with a lot of resale shops while we were down there. Mostly we went to tourist trap things and spent a lot of time just hanging out and having fun in our condo and whatnot while all of that was going down. There's a lot of different places we went to go see and do and things like that. And if you guys are interested in, you know, hearing more about what happened while we were down there, I got quite a few souvenirs and things. I could do another video and we can talk about some of the places we went and what we did while we were down there. Definitely can do that. But if you want to see that, let me know in the comments below. Otherwise, you know, we'll just keep talking about anime because, you know, that's what we're going on. So after we were done with the vacation, or I should say with the Florida part of the vacation, it was time for Anime Week in Atlanta. So we came on up to Atlanta, hung out on Wednesday before the cons, spent the night at a Red Roof Inn, met up with Sailor Death and Potato Baron and quite a few other guys that we were all going to be rooming with. And the next day we got checked into our hotel over at the Renaissance Waverly, which is where Anime Week in Atlanta is held, and then went on our traditional trip to Walmart before the con to pick up on snacks and other things. And while we were there, we had a couple of bouts, had to make some stops. There were some medical emergencies and things that had to take place, so we were all just kind of hanging out and whatnot there. And while we were there, we decided to go check out the electronics section. And lo and behold, go figure, walking into a Walmart in Atlanta, in the Atlanta area, close to AWA, wound up finding quite a few pieces of anime for sale. So I just had to pick them up because, to be honest, new anime, new releases available on Blu-ray, I got the best price. These definitely were going for quite a bit more in the dealer's hall at the convention, and that is something to say. A lot of times the prices in the dealer's hall are not the best of prices, especially on new things, which is why I don't buy a lot of new stuff from the dealer's hall. I instead buy older stuff where prices can still be a little inflated from time to time. It just kind of depends on how in demand that specific piece is. But either way, it was really cool. I found a couple of these things, picked up a couple of items for my camera. In fact, one of them was an SD card, which is what I'm actually recording to now, and might actually be some of the cause for some of the weird video and audio problems I've had over the last couple of videos, and hopefully I've fixed that. But we'll see how that goes on that part, but let's get back into the anime, I guess. First up is something, I've owned this for quite a time, but then it was recently released, thanks to Funimation here, on Blu-ray, and I just had to pick it up. It is The Girl Who Leapt Through Time. This is a really, really cool show. This is the first movie by the director that I remember, because I believe I remember it was The Girl Who Leapt Through Time, then Summer Wars. There might have been something else, and then the Boy and the Beast is like the most recent one to have come out. One of the most recent ones from this director, and it was definitely cool to pick up. I definitely enjoyed this one. It's not old school per se. It's definitely a much newer piece. There's no cell animation with this, but it's a really cool story about a girl who gains the ability to basically leap through time, and how she deals with having this ability in order to make her life better, make changes, and things like that, while she is trying to basically find herself. It's a really cool show. Some of the taglines: time waits for no one. After waking up late, flunking her pop quiz, and embarrassing herself on numerous occasions, and starting to fire in her home economic class, high school student Makoto Kono figures she's just having one of those days. Just when she thinks she's made it through, the brakes on her bike malfunction, putting her on a collision course with a speeding train. The life-ending accident would have been the perfect end of the worst day ever, but the strangest thing happens. She leaps backwards in time. definitely an interesting story, one that I actually really enjoy. And this this version here, thanks to Funimation, you've got Japanese subtitles, you've got English voice acting. It's here on the, this version has DVD, Blu-ray, and then it's also available in ultraviolet, so you can pop it in anywhere. So I love all the ultraviolet stuff. I haven't opened this yet, but I need to so I can get the UV code and fill it out, and that way, no matter where I am, whether or not I have the disc, I could potentially watch this at any point in time. So definitely really cool. Fun one. And hopefully be available for purchase, actually. Really cool piece. The Girl Who Leapt Through Time. All right. So moving on. To another one that I had recently actually seen. A friend of mine, Sailor Death, actually showed it to me when he was visiting up here earlier in the summer. And then I saw it on the shelf, and I knew I had to buy it. Like I said, it's continuation from the same director, Mamoru Hosoda's, director of Summer Wars, Wolf Children. That's the other one. So it's Girl Who Leapt Through Time, Summer Wars, Wolf Children, and then The Boy and the Beast. This is another really cool one, and like I said, this isn't, exactly old school per se, but it was definitely a really cool pickup. Either way, it's a really good, really fun anime. It's a very enjoyable movie. It's 119 minutes long, obviously, just like the other one, presented in widescreen format. This version here is DVD, Blu-ray, and Ultraviolet, once again, thanks to Funimation. So you got all of that here with this one, so, you can watch it anywhere, whenever you want, and, this is a really cool, story. It's kind of a coming-of-age story, but there's also fantastical elements and things like that, because, basically, I guess there's the world of man, and then there's the world of beasts, and then, I guess part of the lore is that a beast, at some point, if they become king or whatever, they can then become a spirit, and then kind of move on from there. And I guess in the way it goes, this little boy basically walks out on his family, all this other stuff, and then gets found by a beast who is looking to train a disciple. And so he picks him up, and he becomes his disciple. And so he starts training in martial arts and stuff with the beast in the world of beastmen. as a human, definitely an interesting one. Really cool show. I guess, one of the comments on the back here, Mamoru Hosoda ranks first among the Japanese animation directors, seen as successors to now-retired industry giant Hayao Miyazaki, and for good reason. And it is true. This is a really, really cool, really awesome, compelling story. Lots of fun. Definitely an interesting one. Cool animation. One you can definitely go pick up on store shelves now. So that is The Boy and the Beast. Okay, and then the final piece that I picked up while I was at Walmart is another Blu-ray, and it was a very recent release thanks to Disney finally actually putting this out. It is an old Miyazaki film that hasn't been released here in the U.S. And so it is, well, I guess it's not really a Miyazaki film, it's a Ghibli film at least. I'm not sure Miyazaki actually directed it, but his studio brought it out, and I guess this actually was brought out, I'm sorry, this was not brought out by Disney, this was actually brought out by Universal, I guess, and it is Only Yesterday. This is one that I own on Laserdisc, because I pretty much own all of the Ghibli films on Laserdisc, but I hadn't seen it, and now I have a chance to actually sit down and watch it and understand it, because obviously I can't, I don't understand Japanese, my understanding is very rudimentary about all of that, so it's definitely cool to get an English translation. I guess this is a film by Isao Takahata, and Miyazaki was the general producer on this. They say it's a gorgeous, a rare and powerful film. I don't know a whole lot about here about this. This is a PG film that is of some length that I can't read on the side of this thing at all. But it's a movie length. So having lived her whole life in this city, 27-year-old Teiko decides to visit her relatives in the countryside. As she travels, memories of her youth resurface, and after meeting young farmer Toshio, she wonders if she's been true to the dreams of her childhood self. Deftly switching between past and present, Only Yesterday is a masterpiece of time and tone, rich with humor and stirring emotion, and beautifully animated by Studio Ghibli, one of the world's most revered animation studios. From Academy Award-nominated director Isao Takahata and general producer Hayao Miyazaki, this critically acclaimed film has never before been released in North America until now. in celebration of its 25th anniversary. So definitely an interesting one here. Only yesterday. Can't wait to actually pop it in and sink my teeth into this and figure out what it's all about. Definitely cool there. Okay, so like I said, you know, that was Thursday of the con at Anime Week in Atlanta. We were there at the event, and then from there we went to the con. While we were there, I got a chance to check out the dealer's room, and one of my main dealers, my man Otaku Joe, was definitely at Anime Week in Atlanta, and I was very pleased to see him. As far as I'm concerned, the dealer's hall down at Anime Week in Atlanta is pretty sparse of just about everything, at least that I'm looking for. There's a couple of video game dealers, and I'll go from dealer to dealer in order to see who has the best price and certain things that I'm looking for if they happen to have it. But as far as DVDs, anime, especially old school stuff goes, Joe is where it's at. He definitely specializes in older anime, a lot of resale stuff, finding things, and selling them. So I got a chance to pick up quite a few older pieces that I'd been looking for. Now, I had talked about it in my pickups video from Yomacon. Unfortunately, when he was at AWA, he didn't have any of his Laserdiscs. I was really looking forward to seeing him there and buying some Laserdiscs, but there just wasn't enough room in order to bring all of that there. He didn't have a big enough table, things like that, and so it just didn't happen. And well, I got a chance to pick up all the Laserdiscs when I was at Yomacon, so it gave me a chance to actually spend some money, plunk some money down on him, and get some anime, and I was definitely pleased to be able to do all of that. And so let's go over all of the cool pickups that I got from from Otaku Joe. These are some really cool pieces. I'm very happy to now own them. So first up is Go Nagai's new Cutie Honey collection 1 and 2. This is an ADV Essential Anime Collection version, remastered in 5.1. Her entire body is a concealed weapon, is the tagline on this one. If you don't know about Cutie Honey, Cutie Honey is the original Cutie Honey, which I think I talked about in a previous pickup video, because I picked up the original Cutie Honey thanks to Discotech. It's about a girl who is a cyborg, and she changes into this form called Cutie Honey. Her name's Honey, and then she turns into Cutie Honey, and then she battles these evil beings and whatnot and saves the world. And so that's kind of what it goes. And the big thing with it is she's kind of the first magical girl, effectively. And then this version here, new Cutie Honey, is a OVA, if I'm remembering correctly. And it's the whole thing's 240 minutes long. I think it's 8 or 12 episodes, I believe, between all of this. Let's see here. If I look, it's a reversible cover. So you got two discs on the inside, some really cool artwork there. And then you can actually pull the cover out in order to see. So you got collection 1, collection 2. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. So yeah, it's 8 eight different episodes here. So yeah, this is, like I thought, it's the OVA. And so you can kind of see her battle suit here as Cutie Honey. And of course, in the front, you know, the suit coming undone. It's kind of one of the big things about this one. This is definitely rated 17 plus, according to the anime rating system that's used on a lot of these animes. This is definitely not one for kids. There's quite a bit of nudity actually going on here with this, so definitely one to watch out for. So what's some more here about this? The forces of evil were looking for trouble. They found Cutie. In a futuristic world where evil comes in all shapes and sizes, she is the ultimate weapon. She's Cutie Honey, a one-woman SWAT team whose android chassis is capable of changing at will into a dazzling array of hard-hitting, curvaceous bodies, each with its own set of special skills, weapons, and other impressive physical attributes. Gonagai's legendary android superhero is back and hitting the bad guys where it hurts most in this new all-inclusive DVD collection with dazzling, newly remastered audio. Honey's never been hotter or sounded better. So that's kind of the gist about this one. Definitely, this is a version that I had been looking for. This version here with the updated audio quality, updated visuals. This is kind of the pinnacle. As far as I know, currently, this is kind of the pinnacle of Cutie Honey. As far as if you're looking for new Cutie Honey, the OVA from the 90s. This is definitely the one to pick out. So the original set here came out in 1994, and then the second set came out in 96. So the first collection, the first four OVAs was 94, and the last four OVAs was 96. And then the packaging design, this version came out in 2004. So definitely a really cool one. This is definitely up on the top of most old school otaku's lists. Anybody who's been, you know, watching anime and stuff from the 90s, this is one to look out for. Was really, really pleased to find it, down there at AWA and pick it up from Otaku Joe. So, thank you for, having that available for me. And now I actually own a copy. Definitely one to look out for if you happen to find it in the wild. Really cool. But obviously, it is 17 plus. There's quite a bit of nudity and other things in this, so young ones, take caution with that. Okay, so let's move on. The next one up here is something that I did not ever expect to actually see out in the wild. And in fact, the format, the version that I have of this is really, really cool because I've only seen the movie. At this point, haven't seen any of the other stuff, so it's really cool to actually get some more of these things. And I've never seen this specific edition out in the wild ever, except for there at the booth at Otaku Joe. So I definitely had to pick it up. And what am I talking about? I am talking about Crusher Joe. And this is the movie and the OVA. So it's got the movie and the two OVAs. So the movie is 125 minutes long. The Ice Prison OVA is 59 minutes. And the Ultimate Weapon Ash is 54 minutes long. So total runtime here is 3 hours and 58 minutes. So like 4 hours of Crusher Joe action. And so what is Crusher Joe? Well, kind of from what I remember of having seen the movie, and I've only seen bits and pieces, little bits about, so I had not the most knowledgeable about Crusher Joe, but it's a futuristic anime set in the future. Humans are in space, intergalactic, and things like that. And Joe has a team, and I think they're kind of like bounty hunters, though they may be kind of like policemen in certain ways or whatnot. But that's kind of the most of what I actually know here. And so this version here was released by Animego. It's got two discs here. So you got the disc number one, which is in a sleeve that you can push here to the side, and that's the movie. And then you got disc two, which is the two OVAs. Got your standard issue Animego insert. Very minimalistic design. This case is a really interesting case, nice and hard, which is definitely cool. So the original movie came out in 83, and then the OVAs came out in 1989, and then 97, it looks like. And then there was some U.S. releases in 97 and 2002, as far as all of that goes. So I guess a little bit here. The galaxy is a strange and dangerous place, and there are times when even the United Space Force can't help. And that's where the Crushers come in. Skilled troubleshooters who deal with any problem, large or small, for a fee. Large only. And there's no better Crusher than Crusher Joe. But when Joe and his team are hired to medevac a cryogenically frozen heiress to the planet Mikola, the heiress gets stolen during a hyperspace jump. Before they know it, the team gets accused of space piracy by the United Space Force and suspended by Crusher HQ. In order to clear their names, they have to travel to the most lawless planet in the galaxy and take on the notorious Big Murphy, a pirate so nasty that his idea of a good time is blowing up entire planets. So yeah, I mean, they're a bunch of bounty hunters, effectively. They're, you know, muscle for hire, set in the distant future out in space. Definitely a really cool one to pick up. This is one of those gems, so to speak, as far as old school collectors go. This is something I've heard about and never seen in the wild until I finally saw it, and I just had to pick it up. So that is Crusher Joe, the OVAs, and the movie. So, moving right along, another one that I picked up that I have actually been looking for to actually own a copy of it is Video Girl I. And it's I, not AI. Video Girl I. This is released by Viz Video, and apparently was also helped and distributed by Pioneer, this edition here. It's a 6-episode OVA based off of the manga by the same name. Video Girl I is a really interesting story about a guy who goes into this mysterious video store, and he basically, and there's a bunch of girls. It's like, it's all girls, you know, so you think it's like, you know, he's down on his luck, he's looking for love, and the store has, you know, videos of girls, so you have your own private show. Well, he pops it into his VHS deck, which in turn winds up being a problem because it's a defective VHS deck. He pops it in, and then out of the TV pops this girl, pops I. And of course she's pissed because he has a broken TV or a broken VCR, so she's supposed to have bigger boobs and all this other stuff. But and you know, things kind of change from there. It's the job of the video girls to get their master's wish happen. That's what their job is. And then things happen and people fall in love, and it's just it's an interesting one. And without going too much into detail, I don't want to give too much away, but it's a really, really cool, cool show. Viz brought it out in the manga form, and I first was reading the story in Mixzine way back in the day. Not Mixzine, I guess it was Animerica Extra. Yeah, that's what it was, Animerica Extra. The manga was running in there, and then I kind of picked up some of the manga, so it kind of went from there. This is kind of cool. There's a GameStop receipt inside from, I guess, where this was originally picked up from. You still got the Pioneer thing and standard insert with some information and stuff. So definitely a cool one to pick up here. So like I said, this is a 6-episode OVA, 4x3 format, came out back in the 90s. And it's a really, really cool show. I guess it was animated back in 1992 is when this was originally released and then brought out here. So it's 180 minutes. It is bilingual, so you got the English and Japanese. One of the best things about DVDs and Blu-rays is typically you can get both. So whether you're a fan of the sub or the dub, you can have them either way. Definitely a really cool one. Definitely an interesting story and one to look out for, and that is Video Girl I. Alright, so moving right along, we come to a disc that, yes, once again, another disc I never expected to see out in the wild. And go figure, Joe just happens to know where to find stuff that I never expect to actually see out in the wild. And this is something that I originally first saw after I found it available when I was looking through all the anime available through Netflix, and just kind of having everything sent to me. Before I finally got rid of my Netflix subscription, because I'd pretty much gone through all the anime. It is Odin, Photon Space Sailor Starlight. So, what is Odin? It is a space opera, basically, is what this is. This is set in a distant future of 2099, in a future where humans have learned how to sail the Sea of Stars. And how they do that is they build these giant spaceships that are built like old galleons and whatnot, so they've got sails. And what they are is they're solar sails, effectively, but rather than actually using solar energy to power them and push them away, they use giant lasers. So a laser hits it, and then that's how they get from point A to point B, in these giant space sailors' ships. And so this new ship that was just recently built called the Starlight sets off on its journey. And apparently one of the really cool things about it is it's got a special space drive that allows it to go off the rails effectively and can kind of explore on its own. And so there's a bunch of crackpot, young people, just fresh out of the academy, riding this thing. I've only seen the dub of this. I've not seen the Japanese version. The version I have was just dubbed. In fact, they had two different versions. There was the dub version and then the Japanese cut, because there were like two different cuts. So I've only kind of seen the English version. It's definitely, the dub is laughable at best. It was definitely odd. This version here was released by US Manga Corps on DVD. It's got English, it's got Japanese and English with subtitles, and it includes the original director's cut and the international version. So you got both versions of this, and if I remember right, each version is slightly different. Like the English version that I have, that I've seen, which I think is the international version, though it might be the director's cut, I'm not really sure which, was like an hour and a half, whereas the other version was like 2 hours long. So I think the international version was probably 2 hours long. But yeah, this was one I never expected to see. A bunch of young bucks and a couple of old farts who are actually running the ship, who are the captain and whatnot, and the bosun. They're kind of calling the shots, and they go searching for things and find their way to, I guess, searching for Odin. Which is some like distant world with other life, basically. Humans are, as far as they know, kind of like the only ones out in the Sea of Stars, and then they go searching to find other alien life. It's a weird show. It came out in 85. Definitely has that old 80s space vibe theme to it. The animation quality isn't the best. Very hard up on rock ballads, stuff, 80s hair music, things like that, is kind of like what you expect to actually see from this. But either way, though, definitely an interesting pickup. And when I saw it, I had to buy it. Because I remember watching it, I thought it was kind of interesting, and obviously it's right up my alley as far as collecting goes. So, I'm a sucker for bad shows if they've got some nostalgia for me. But either way, that's Odin, Photon Space Sailor Starlight. So, to the final piece that I picked up from Otaku Joe is one that, yeah, once again, I never expected to see this DVD ever. Didn't even realize a DVD had ever been brought out by this. It is the first VHS tape I bought after I turned 18. And the reason why it was the first VHS tape I bought after I turned 18 is because I originally wanted to get a copy of this, but my parents wouldn't buy it for me, and my grandfather wouldn't buy it for me, because they looked on the back and they saw it said 16 and up, and it looked a little racy, so they decided not to get it for me. And well, I mean, it is definitely a little racy. The storyline is definitely etchy, but it's one that I actually really, really enjoyed. So when I saw it on his shelf, I knew I had to pick it up, and it is Sprite Between Two Worlds. So the Askew Review says the anime equivalent of Sybil. This version here has got English and Japanese, which is really cool, because the original VHS I had was only the English dub, which is definitely weird because, like I said, there are sex scenes in this. This is not for the young ones. Technically, it's very etchy. You're going to see boobies and sexual acts happening, but you don't actually see it actually happening, I guess. It's kind of the best way to describe it. It's not quite hentai, but it's almost there. But overall, like, it was a storyline that I really enjoyed. But yeah, like, during those scenes, like, it was weird because most of the time I remember hentai growing up, and if there was an English dub, the English voice actor or actress would basically be throughout the whole thing, so they'd like dub it all. But for this, they actually left the original Japanese voices in for those scenes. So it's definitely weird, odd and jarring, but after having seen the Japanese version, I was able to pick out that's exactly what had happened. Basically, the kind of the storyline is there's this guy who goes to live with his family, his cousin in another town. And apparently, like, the two of them, he's a guy and then she's a girl, and they used to play a lot when they were kids. Well, apparently, inadvertently, he creates an alternate personality with this girl. So, Manami is her name, but she has a alternate personality who's known as Nami, who's kick-ass, not afraid of anything. She's kind of the... Manami is the good girl, and then Nami is the bad girl. So, basically, by calling out her name, Nami, he's able to turn Manami into Nami. And then I guess after they go to sleep, it changes over. And so it's an odd storyline, to kind of wrap your head around, but it's definitely a really interesting melodrama, between these two. And obviously they've got, you know, romantic inclinations between the two of them. He likes Nami and Manami, and both Manami and Nami like him. And it's really weird, to say the least. But it's a 3-episode OVA, 80 minutes long total between it. And this version here was brought out by US Manga Corps, Central Park Media, and definitely a really interesting one to pick up. So, you know, if you see it out in the wild, it's something to potentially look into. Obviously, if you're old enough, it is Sprite Between Two Worlds. Okay. So we're down to the wire here. After Anime Week in Atlanta was done, we spent a night at my parents' on the way back, and then went out to eat, and then headed home. And on the way home, we stopped at a few resale shops, because there's a couple there in the place where my around where my parents live, and then coming through Indianapolis. Indiana, there are quite a few disc replays in that area. So, you know, we stopped at quite a few of them, and in the process picked up some new stuff. So let's kind of go over some of the stuff that I picked up. So first up is a continuation of some of the things that I picked up from the different ones, and it is the Animated Classics of Japanese Literature. And this one is The Izu Dancer and The Dancing Girl. And Ghost Story. So it's three different Japanese stories, animated and whatnot. Don't know a whole lot about here, but obviously this is a continuation. Central Park Media brought it out, originally animated in 86. Here's a little bit about it. So The Izu Dancer by Kawabata Yusunari. Won the Nobel Prize for Literature in 1968. His writings include over 100 short palm of the hand stories. These stories emphasize the commonplace episodes that nonetheless make undeniable impressions on human lives. And so The Izu Dancer is a young student falls in love with a traveling dancer. Their love is sincere, but social differences may tear them apart. Then there's The Dancing Girl by Mori Ogari. Mori Ogai, that's it, spent much of his youth as an army physician. Upon his return to civilian life, Mori turned his talents to writing and became an important figure in the Japanese romantic literary movement. So The Dancing Girl is about a Japanese man working in turn-of-the-century Berlin, fathers a child with an impoverished dancer. Together, they strive to build a home and family, but political difficulties force the father to choose between his career and the woman he loves. And then finally, there is A Ghost Story by Yozumi Yakumo. Born in Greece as Laficado Harn, Yakumo spent his youth in Europe and America. In 1890, his travels brought him to Japan, where he taught English, married into a traditional samurai family, and became a citizen. He is the author of many books on the Japanese culture. So a ghost story is about a blind lute player chants the old legend of a great battle between the Genji and the Hiki families. His music attracts the attention of the Hiki dead, whose ghost requests a performance. So, that's more animated classics. Definitely an interesting to pick up, one to pick up. They definitely look odd, but I'm really liking the design here for the dancing girl. I'm not sure if that is the woman the guy marries or not, but definitely looks like an interesting one to look at. That is that one. Okay, moving right along. We have Google 13, The Professional. Now, you might remember from last week's episode on what to buy. A DVD, Blu-ray version of The Professional Gogo 13 has recently been released, thanks to Discotech. So this version here, this is the DVD cut, one of the original older cuts here. So this was brought out by Urban Vision. It's 90 minutes long and presented in Japanese and English audio, fully digitally remastered in 5.1. Just a little bit more about Gogo. He's a hitman who is known for basically getting the job done. If you're on his list, you're already dead. On his 62nd birthday, oil baron Leonard Dawson witnesses the public assassination of his son and heir, Robert. From this point on, Leonard becomes obsessed with revenge on the hitman, codenamed Gogo 13. Dawson spares nothing to enlist the CIA, FBI, and U.S. military in an unrelenting manhunt for his son's. As Gogo's survival depends on stopping Dawson himself, the hunter and the hunted chase each other in a breathless game of kill or be killed. So that is Gogo 13. Definitely an interesting one to pick up. Obviously, I still want the Blu-ray. But when I saw this, I knew I had to own this version. I'm definitely all for multi-formats, as it were. So definitely a good one to pick up. And obviously, mature audiences only on this one, please. Okay, down to our last DVD release. And this one here is one I had been looking for, and let's just say I actually I was fretting when I was at AWA. I saw this on the shelf. It was available. I could have purchased it, but I opted for Cutie Honey instead, because I've seen Photon. I've seen this a couple of times, and I was like, you know what? Let's hold off for now. I've never seen Cutie Honey. I've never seen Crusher Joe. I need to pick those up. So I went ahead and picked those up. And then it turned out that, let's just face it. I was able to find this myself for much less at Disc Replay. And I'm talking about Photon the Idiot Adventures. And I realize I might have already picked this up. I don't remember. All of my discs are over in boxes, and I need to pull them out and catalog them, and hopefully we'll be doing that very soon. But either way, though, it's from the creative team behind Tenchi Muyo. Photon the Idiot Adventures is a 6-episode OVA. There is some nudity happening on in this one, so, you know, you gotta kind of watch out for a little bit of that. It's 180 minutes, released by US Manga Corps, and it's in 4x3. Format. There's a lot of people who really love this show. It's an interesting one. It's basically the story of a boy who finds a magic marker, so to speak, and he then stumbles onto the sleeping area of this girl who I guess is alien, special powers, things like that, and he writes on his forehead and then her forehead, and it basically says, he writes Baka, which of course in the English version they translate to idiot. And so that's kind of what it is. It's the adventures of this lovable idiot known as Photon, and then the girl that he finds, and basically she's forced to follow him because he brands her. and then craziness ensue, and that's just kind of how it goes from there. Photon, a young man with a kind heart and superhuman strength, leaves his village on Sandy Planet in search of a runaway friend. During this heroic quest, he is accidentally engaged to a renegade space pilot. Now they're on the run from the evil Emperor of the Galaxy and his bumbling henchmen. But even worse than the incompetent bad guys are the disastrous cooking contest, exploding spas, and cheerleading aliens. So it's definitely a wacky, zany type show. This one here, from the same creative team that brought you Tenchi Muyo. A lot of slapstick and other things going on here. But overall, definitely an interesting, fun show. And one that I've personally enjoyed over the years. It's been a long time since I last saw this. But either way, it's definitely a fun one. So that is Photon, The Idiot Adventures. And, well, I guess that brings me to the end of this collection. Quite a few pieces here that I picked up, and it was definitely fun to kind of talk about all these different things and eventually to sit down and actually watch this stuff. One of the cool things is this stuff is not in boxes, so I could at any point in time just pop any of these in rather than having to dig through my boxes to find other stuff that's in there. But either way, though, really cool, awesome stuff to pick up. What do you guys think? Any of these that you guys have seen or want to know a little bit more about, hit me up and let me know. You can always hit me up in the comment section below or on Tumblr, Twitter, Facebook, or up on the website. All those links will be in the description below for all of that. And if I can find links to some of this stuff, they'll be there as well. If this is your first time tuning in or actually watching all this stuff, thank you. Thanks for listening to me up to this point. If you're interested in finding more stuff that I brought out, I encourage you to hit one of these two videos to the left or right of me. It's going to put, going to basically give you a little bit more views of some of the stuff that I put out recently. And of course, if you like the type of stuff I put out, I encourage you to hit that subscribe button above my head if you haven't done so before. Puts you front row and center whenever I release something new, as it should show up in your inbox. Obviously, though, remember there have been changes to YouTube's notification strategies, so just to double check, when you do hit that subscribe button and become a subscriber, make sure to hit that that little bell next to the subscribe button in order to make sure you set yourself as actually receiving notifications. That way you won't miss anything when I release something new up in the future. And of course, those of you who have been with me up to this point and aren't new or whatnot and just following on, thanks for tuning in. Definitely really awesome. Obviously, everybody who's tuning in, I encourage you to take a look at my Patreon and maybe become a patron of mine. Either otherwise, share out stuff, chat with me, let me know what you guys think about all the stuff that I picked up and what is potentially to come here in the coming months or whatnot. And hopefully you guys will have a really nice holiday coming up here soon. I know I'm hoping to myself, and hopefully I'll get some really cool things here to talk about in the new year. But either way, though, guys, I gotta thank you once again for tuning in, but I guess that's all the time I have for today. So this is Nate, the old school otaku, signing off. How can I hold all of these things in my hands? It's really difficult.